The Soviet Union, 1944. The Red Army finishes liberating its occupied territories from the Nazis. Germans destroy everything in their wake. The summer of 1944, Hitler, in his headquarters in the East, the Wolf Slayer, refuses to admit defeat. He continues to have faith in his ultimate victory. Even though the American and British allies have successfully landed in Normandy, it is the second front Stalin had demanded. The Soviets prepare to invade Germany. Leningrad is saved after a 900-day siege and almost 2 million civilian and military deaths. The German prisoners face the survivors. But the reactions differ from place to place. July 17, 1944, 57,000 German prisoners parade through Moscow. Young Roman Shenko is in the crowd of Muscovites. He recalls, "We saw the Germans up close. What was astonishing was the silence. We didn't say a word, neither did the Germans." Gamina Borovleva remembers, "I saw people crying. I heard an old lady in the crowd say, 'My God, they're just like our poor children.'" By parading 1,000 German officers and 20 generals in this fashion, Stalin shows off his power to his allies and his people. Does Stalin want to become master of the world? July 1944. Stalin's organs crushed Germany's defenses. The Red Army's mobility is astounding. The Americans gave Stalin the financial support, the steel, and the rare ores needed to build 55,000 T-34 tanks, some of the most efficient war machinery in activity, in addition to hundreds of thousands of trucks, jeeps, and armored vehicles. The Soviets are advancing in Poland. They are almost in Warsaw when they receive the order from Stalin to stay put. Warsaw, August 1st, 1944. The Polish resistance movement rises up against the Germans to liberate the city before the Red Army gets there. They want to avoid falling under Soviet control. In 1939, Stalin had already carved up Poland with his ally of the time, Hitler. In Katyn, Stalin had 20,000 captured Polish officers executed. He wanted to get rid of any hostile elites. In 1944, he forbids anyone from assisting the Polish resistance fighters. he does nothing to help the Allies in their attempt to supply weapons to the rebels via parachute. He allows the resistance fighters to be massacred by the SS, who completely destroy the city. Marshal Zhukov writes in his memoirs, "Stalin told me, we couldn't share our border with a bourgeois Poland. The Red Army conquers Warsaw, or what's left of it, and goes on to occupy the rest of Poland. As they move through the country, the Soviet troops discover the true Nazi horror. The Jewish extermination camp at Majdanek." Russian author Vasily Grossman, a war correspondent at the time, witnesses the liberation of the camp. The first thing he does is search for his mother, who he hasn't heard from since June 1941. The few survivors don't give him much hope. His mother's ashes were probably used to fertilize the SS's cabbage patches. Grossman discovers the true scope of the Nazi barbary: Belzec, Sobibor, and Treblinka. In his article, "The Hell of Treblinka," Grossman tells the world how the SS exterminated the Jews while the Red Army was approaching. Grossman writes, "Can we find within us the strength to imagine what the people in these chambers felt, what they experienced during their last moments of life? Packed so tight that their bones cracked. What are the pictures now passing before the people's glassy, dying eyes? Pictures of childhood? Of the happy days of peace? Consciousness dims. It is the moment of their last agony." Historian Antony Bivor writes, "Grossman was quick to understand that Soviet authorities didn't appreciate his reports on what would later be called the Holocaust. Stalinist policy refused to create different categories of suffering. The victims of Nazism on Soviet soil received the status of citizen of the Soviet Union. The word Jew never appeared in any official reports on the atrocities committed, even on the corpses that bore the yellow star." Stalin's position on war crimes was clear: do not divide the dead. To Stalin, the Soviet people had suffered just as much as the Jews. Ukraine, 1944. Stalin wants to cover up Ukraine's involvement in anti-Semitic crimes and its widespread collaboration with the Germans during the Great Patriotic War. The Ukrainians, past victims of famines organized by the Bolsheviks, fought alongside the Germans in the Ukrainian Legion, the Ukrainian Liberation Army, and the 14th Waffen Grenadier Division of the SS. Purification was managed by a Ukrainian, Nikita Khrushchev, who never recoiled before inflicting mass terror or flinched in his devotion to Stalin. Khrushchev complains about the return of the Jews who miraculously survived. Their houses are now occupied by Ukrainians. Khrushchev grumbles, "All these Abramoviches are invading my lands like a murder of crows." Is Stalin an anti-Semite? He is a politician above all. His attitude is unclear and changes according to the times and the circumstances. He doesn't hesitate to send Molotov's wife to the Gulag, along with the other members of the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee, created in 1942 to influence international public opinion. he harasses Jewish doctors who have too many ties with foreign countries. But he always keeps one man by his side, Lazar Kaganovich, nicknamed Stalin's Last Jew. Stalin's anti-Semitism was a mixture of old prejudices, of nationalist mistrust with regards to a stateless population, and of suspicions against his enemies, who were often Jewish. At Yalta, Stalin says to Roosevelt, "The Jews are profiteers and parasites." 15 years earlier, in 1929, he founds Birobidzhan, the Jewish autonomous oblast in the Soviet Far East. The region's official language is Yiddish, favored over Hebrew, which is considered too religious. Under the guise of repopulating this hostile region and promoting agriculture, this displacement is really a form of deportation. Stalin rules. But he barely manages to control the entire country. He feels he is surrounded by enemies, hunted down by his secret police. Nothing can get in the way of this utopia. The transformation of Russia into a gigantic field populated by peasants who are now workers of the land. No more izbas and ancestral farms. Everyone will live in communities, in kolkhozes. The people will produce millions of tons of wheat, which the state will sell to purchase the machinery to build tractors, tanks, and planes. And in this way, the Soviet Union will catch up on its 100-year lag in only 5 years. This is the first of his 5-year plans. But Stalin is immediately confronted with the resistance of the peasants. They refuse to lose their lands. They reject collectivization. Stalin gives them a slanderous nickname, Kulak, profiteer, or exploiter. He gives a specific definition for the term. Any farmer who uses hired labor, who owns a mill, a creamery, a potato dryer, mechanical agricultural equipment with a motor or livestock. A definition so vague that it opens the door to false accusations, score settling, and rape. The police lash out on those who attempt to hide their grain reserves. The peasants' resistance is so powerful that the state mobilizes 27,000 dekulakizators, communist militants shipped in from the cities, and a miserable group of day workers paid in spoils. Stalin's police reports back. "We remove the peasants' winter clothes and warm undergarments. We take their shoes. We even go so far as to confiscate the pillows under their children's heads and all their religious icons to burn them all." Stalin wants to drag the whole population into the crusade against the peasants. He encourages acts of denunciation. Propaganda screened in the movie theaters show a young Tatar girl from Crimea, Olga Balikina, who is famous for accusing her own father of stealing wheat from his kolkhoz. Congratulated by the party, Olga is cheered by the pioneers, aged 9 to 14, and the Komsomols, aged 15 to 18, the mass youth organizations founded by Lenin. Olga proudly states, "I simply behaved the way all pioneers should behave." She performs the pioneer salute and recites, "Stalin, you are higher than the celestial bodies. Stalin, you are brighter than the sun." In every village, statues of Pavel Morozov are erected to the glory of hero pioneer of the Soviet Union, number 001. A According to legend, largely fabricated by the police, young Pavel gave up his own father, hostile to collectivization, only to be murdered at 14 by his uncle. Two million peasants were sent to prepare land in Siberia. 300,000 others were sent to the gulags, and another 300,000 were executed. Kalinin, who is supposed to represent the peasants to Stalin, doesn't dare tell him that he receives thousands of petitions. Like this one. "The whites robbed us blind, but at least they let us live." The Civil War had caused the famines of 1918 and 1921. Famine organized by Stalin from the early 1930s onward is the most devastating of all, especially in Ukraine. 5 million human beings die of starvation. Dr. Margarita Pogrebetskaya recalls, "We called the famine Holodomor in Ukrainian, extermination by starvation. Everything was taken from these people down to the very last crumb. A mother killed her child with an axe to cook him and feed him to the others. And no one asked any questions." Nadezhda, Stalin's wife, is the only person who speaks to him about the Russian people's suffering. Nowadays, they are often apart. She has taken up her studies again in Moscow. Stalin prefers long stays in the countryside. His chauffeur is Nikolai Vlasik, a policeman who photographs the tyrant's private life. While the members of the Politburo, like Lenin, are fond of Rolls Royces, Stalin prefers American luxury cars, like his Packard. He has 20 dachas built for him. These luxury villas are located all over Russia, and he visits them according to the seasons. He is happy in these villas, constantly singing opera arias. He runs the country through telegrams and detailed letters, and by summoning his collaborators. While his people are starving to death, Stalin fishes for trout and reads a lot. His library counts 20,000 books. He can quote the Bible or Bismarck, a German political model of nationalism. He cheats on his wife with his hairdresser, who shaves him every morning. He plays gorodki, a Russian variation on lawn bowling, with his accomplices. His favorite pastime is planting trees, lemon trees and orange trees. A policeman has begun to appear regularly in the photos. His name is Lavrenty Beria. He's from Georgia, like Stalin. He has been singled out for his exceptional cruelty and sadistic behavior. Beria gets closer and closer to Stalin, who ultimately names him head of the NKVD, the newly named ever-powerful secret police. Stalin introduces him to Roosevelt in Yalta in 1945 as our very own Himmler. Nadezhda fears Beria. She despises him. She returns to Moscow whenever he is around. She writes to Stalin. She dares to mention the lines in front of the empty stores. What she doesn't dare tell him is that the peasants have fled towards the cities and are dying of hunger in the streets. Nadezhda, a kind-hearted woman with strong ideals, no longer recognizes the man she used to call the untamed revolutionary, the new man, She accuses him. An executioner, that's what you've become. On November 7th, 1932, Nadezhda marches alongside the students of the Industrial Academy of Moscow to celebrate the 15th anniversary of the revolution. Stalin, on the balcony of Lenin's mausoleum, seems particularly tense. Right after the army, the police take center stage. The festivities conclude with a great banquet in the Kremlin. Nadezhda is found dead in the couple's bedroom, a bullet through the heart and a gun in hand. She was 31 years old. The police conclude she committed suicide. Word spreads that Stalin killed her in a violent argument. She's entitled to a solemn funeral ceremony. Stalin doesn't attend. Nadezhda's suicide is officially presented as resulting from an acute appendicitis, more than an act of despair. Her suicide appears to be an act of political defiance towards Stalin. The bodies begin to pile up. Artists who once believed that the revolution would bring creative freedom find the official doctrine of social realism imposed upon them by Stalin. All artists, painters, musicians, poets, authors, referred to by Stalin as engineers of the soul, must exalt work, family, fatherland, and above all, the glory of Stalin. Those who aren't in jail or in exile still attempt to resist. Osip Mandelstam, the greatest Russian poet of the time, is arrested and dies of hunger and cold in the Gulag. He had written The Kremlin Highlander. His thick fingers are fatty like worms, but his words are as true as pound weights. His cockroach whiskers laugh, and every killing is a treat for the broad-chested Osset. The community apartments confiscated from the bourgeoisie are packed one family to a room. People are afraid of each other. The great Russian writer Mikhail Bulgakov described these times with his dark brand of humor. Inexplicable things began to occur. People would disappear from the apartment without a trace. One time, a policeman appeared, summoned a tenant, and told him to stop by the station for a moment. The tenant never returned. A second tenant disappeared one Monday. That morning, as usual, a car came to pick him up and take him to work. The car never returned. Vasily Nikolaev recalls his time in prison. There were mostly simple folk. A student sentenced to 10 years in a camp for telling a funny story. A truck driver imprisoned because he looked like Stalin. A barber who didn't have his party card. The manager of a laundry who did have his. And an old man who was overjoyed. He laughed. "I am so very happy that all you communists are also in prison and don't understand why any more than I do." Throughout the Soviet Union, the prison trains had never transported so many deportees to the gulags. Marina Izaichik remembers. There was a hole in the floor and a bucket behind a sheet for bowel movements. The journey lasted 7 days. We slept on the floor. We were let off in the middle of the taiga. Scurvy spread quickly. We began to lose teeth. We built things, made everything with our bare hands. Just wait. Just put up with it. Just wait and be patient. The hundreds of gulag camps, referred to as correctional work camps, become a massive source of free labor for Stalin's Herculean projects, such as the canal linking the Baltic to the White Sea in 1932, the Belomor Canal. 300 kilometers cutting through granite mountains, dug by hand, to the sound of deportee orchestras. On the Belomor Canal, the work pace is relentless. 30,000 deportees die of exhaustion. Louis Aragon, a member of the French Communist Party, writes, "I applaud this principle of human recycling, this prodigious science of re-educating man." Soviet propaganda shows examples of re-education. The deportees working on the canal have been herded together to be filmed under the watchful eyes of the camp police. To go even faster, Yagoda, chief of the secret police, forces the deported engineers to reduce the depth of the canal, which will make all navigation impossible. The only ships that will risk traveling on the canal are the rare Soviet leisure crafts, such as the one belonging to Stalin, who passes through for a few hours to express his dissatisfaction. Later on, he decides to build a better canal with his endless workforce. But first, other grandiose projects must be finished, such as the giant Naprostoy Dam or the massive steelworks at Magnitogorsk. But Stalin has one idea that takes precedence over all others. He wants to build a temple for the people. Where do people come together every day? In the subway. Stalin wants to give his capital the most beautiful subway in the world. Socialist realism also applies to Soviet filmmakers. The site manager is Lazar Kaganovich. He proclaims, "The Moscow subway is part of our fight for a more humane society, for human rights, against slavery. Our Moscow subway is precious, and not just because it is made of marble. In each slab of marble, our socialist work, our blood, our love, our struggle for the new man and for a socialist society shines through." Kaganovich is the man who invented the term Stalinism when he said, "We continue to speak of Lenin and of Leninism, even though Lenin left us quite some time ago. Long live Stalinism." According to historian Simon Sebag Montefiore, Kaganovich sees Stalin as the Robespierre of Russia. Terror and the Gulag are the Politburo's main activities. The Soviets, stuffed with propaganda, concur with the regime. They live poorly, but they have hope. Igor Poglisov recalls. We had our own rituals. Our kayak rides, our nights in tents, our campfire songs. How could we not believe in our revolutionary dream? Our sons would be called October, and our daughters, Stalina. January 30, 1933, through long articles printed in Pravda, the Soviet people learned that in Germany, Adolf Hitler, head of the National Socialist Party, or Nazi for short, has just become chancellor, which is the equivalent of prime minister. A few days later, on February 10, 1933, at the Berlin Sports Palace, through the slogan, "Let's liberate Germany from Marxism," Hitler reminds his countrymen that their main enemy is communism.
Der Kampf gegen den Marxismus wurde damals zum ersten Mal zu einem Kampfziel erhoben. Damals gelobte ich mir zum ersten Mal als unbekannter Eiserner diesen Krieg zu beginnen und mich zu ruhen, bis endlich
in Moscow, Stalin can no longer ignore the threat of an armed conflict with Hitler. January 26, 1934, 17th Congress of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union. To Khrushchev and all the other Stalinists, it is the Congress of the Victors, because Stalin announces staggering results. The five-year plan has reached its goals 1 year ahead of schedule. Industrial production has doubled. The Soviet Union has avoided the great economic crisis that has just rocked Europe and the United States. All the numbers are false, but everyone is overjoyed. Nonetheless, this great communist mass will go down in history as the Congress of the Condemned. Because a bad surprise is waiting for Stalin. Sergei Kirov, the man closest to Stalin, reveals that several delegates have secretly contacted him to replace the tyrant, and 300 of the 1,200 delegates, concerned about the totalitarian concentration of power in one man, vote against Stalin. Over the next few years, Stalin executes or sends to the Gulag 1,108 communists who attended this Congress. In Berlin, Hitler purges the Nazi Party. It's the night of the long knives. To win over both the army and the business sector, he orders the assassination of the very stormtroopers that helped him rise to power. Moscow is impressed by the Führer's violence and the speed of execution. Stalin remarks to his close entourage, "Did you see what's happening in Germany? He's quite a guy, that Hitler. That requires some skill. That's how to treat political adversaries." November 7th, 1934. To celebrate the anniversary of the revolution, Stalin stands at the top of Lenin's mausoleum with Kirov. These are the last images of Stalin's cohort, Leningrad's leading Bolshevik and his hunting partner. Kirov is murdered on December 1st, 1934 in Leningrad, officially by a jealous husband. Kirov's death unleashes a terrible chain reaction. Stalin feels threatened by internal resistance. He declares war on his own people. He plunges his country into one long dark night that ends in 1937 with the Great Purge, a deadly mania that results in 700,000 victims in just 1 year. Stalin, who appears to be praying, takes advantage of this tragedy to accuse his enemies of masterminding a gigantic assassination plot against him and his government. He hunts down Trotskyists and real or imagined opponents, even among the revolution's greatest heroes. Like Nikolai Bukharin, the man who Lenin referred to as the golden boy of the party. Stalin organizes highly spectacular show trials, which will be remembered in history as the Moscow Trials. The accused aren't shown in court. They are in too pitiful a condition, despite the best efforts of the doctors in Lubyanka prison, where they have been tortured. On the other hand, the prosecutor Andrei Vyshinsky is filmed a great deal. After the war, Vyshinsky will become the permanent representative of the Soviet Union to the UN Security Council. Here, his closing arguments are perfectly suited to Stalinist methods. The Moscow trials shake up public opinion around the world. French author André Breton, founder of the Surrealist movement, comments, "A terrible misfortune has fallen upon socialism, trampled by this macabre staging of justice. Stalin is the great instigator, falsifier, and most unforgivable assassin. In the factories, men and women workers alike rally together, demanding punishment for the guilty. On March 11th, 1938, the accused are all sentenced to death. All those who helped Stalin seize power, Bukharin, Kamenev, Zinoviev, 98 members of the Communist Party's Central Committee, the men in charge of the police, and their boss, Yagoda, the majority of the Red Army's high command, led by Marshal Tukhachevsky. Bukharin writes Stalin, "Koba, what will be gained by my death?" Kamenev asks Stalin, who he had saved 20 years earlier, "Do you know what gratitude is?" Stalin replies, "It's a sickness suffered by dogs. The condemned are immediately executed." Nina Poglazova, a Muscovite, explains, "We live in a Soviet world where there is only one rule to the game. Everyone plays by this rule. He stands in the balcony and he lies. Everyone claps, but everyone knows he lies. And he knows we know, but he continues spewing lies, and he is happy that everyone is applauding him." Svetlana Alexeyevich recalls, "My generation grew up with fathers who were either back from the camps or off from the war. Violence was the only thing they could speak to us about. They didn't say much. They mostly drank. It killed them in the end. Those who hadn't been arrested lived in constant fear of it happening. If they weren't arrested, they worried. Why has everyone else been arrested except for me?" Margarita Pogrebetskaya adds, "Our love for our country was infinite. We had the most beautiful of motherlands. The first Soviet automobile, hooray! An illiterate worker discovered the secret to stopping steel from rusting. What a victory! The whole world had known this secret for ages, but we didn't learn that until much later. We were going to be the first to fly over the North Pole. We were going to change the course of great rivers and irrigate eternal deserts." Stalin starts building a new Moscow, which will be the showcase of socialism. Just like Hitler and Mussolini, he wants massive Roman structures, a 500-meter-tall tower topped with a statue of Lenin. He starts by destroying the historical and religious heart of the city. Let's make a clean sweep of the past. Stalin has his propaganda machine working at full speed, fabricating work heroes like Alexei Stakhanov, the greatest miner of all times. He can extract 14 times more coal than anyone else, 100 tons in just one day. This is impossible, of course, but the Stakhanovist movement is born. Young Maria Demchenko from Ukraine is another example. She's reportedly able to pick 1 ton of beets per day. Stalin asks her, "Can't you pick 2 tons? And she replies, "I can do even better than that, Comrade Stalin." Or Mamlakat Nakhangova, a young Tajik girl who picked a mountain of cotton while learning to read. Stalin dons traditional Tajik attire to encourage the peoples of Central Asia to surpass expectations as well. Surpass. Stalin dreams of surpassing America, the country he admires so much. All these Stakhanovist feats are pure inventions. And so begins the era of lies in Soviet industry. Terrorized workers and factory managers are threatened if they don't fulfill their quotas. So they lie about everything: quality, quantity, reliability, yield. The final act of terror takes place in Mexico City in 1940. Trotsky finally believes he is safe. Tirelessly, he continues to write, criticizing Stalinism in his books. On August 20th, 1940, Stalin has his head smashed in by one of his secret agents. But as pointed out by historian Boris Souvarine, Trotsky is partly responsible for Stalinism. Souvarine writes, "Trotsky contributed to creating, along with Lenin, the dangerous myth of the dictatorship of the proletariat, with a total disregard for Marx's real ideas, which were invoked right and left. They demonstrated a carelessness that provided Stalin with all the tools he needed to take control." Stalin is haunted by the ghost of war. 1941. The threat is becoming clearer. France's sudden defeat in the face of the German armored tanks forces Stalin to look at just how far behind his own armed forces are lagging. He needs more time. But Hitler attacks first. On June 22, 1941. 4 years later. 1945. The Red Army enters Berlin. Young Aglaya Nesteru is a radio sergeant. She recalls, "Our homeland had been liberated. Now we were dying for a foreign land. We were told that the enemy had to be destroyed. Even if everyone understood, it's so sad to die. We would finally understand what their land, their houses, looked like. The first thing that surprised us was the quality of the roads. The size of the farms, the pretty curtains, the white tablecloths, the expensive china. Why did they need to go to war if they lived so well? Back home, too many people lived in mud huts. We could go days without hot food or drink. We slept on hay. While here in Germany, we found coffee that was still hot and white sheets. The Russians also found people who had committed suicide out of fear of retaliation and rape. Nine million Soviet soldiers are dead. 10 million have been injured. 3 million will remain invalids. Their parents and children are also gone. 20 million civilians have been killed. The Soviet people have given new meaning to the word sacrifice. They mobilized to save the world from Nazism. On April 30th, 1945, Hitler commits suicide in his bunker. He is responsible for 70 million deaths. Stalin's flag waves over the Reichstag, the devastated Senate House, symbol of the German Empire. On May 8, 1945, Nazi Germany surrenders. The Soviet people won the war. But in the eyes of the world, the true victor is Stalin. August 12, 1945, in Moscow's Red Square. Stalin organizes a huge sports parade. Several thousand athletes have come from all across the Soviet Union. They are mostly women because the men are dead. The ritual has begun again. The regime's dignitaries climb to the top of Lenin's tomb, accompanied this time by a foreigner, a rare honor. The guest is American General Dwight Eisenhower, who was commander-in-chief of the Allied forces and organized the Normandy invasion. Stalin has the country's remaining young people march for 5 hours to dazzle Eisenhower and impress America. Soon to become the imperialist enemy. France's General de Gaulle is perhaps the person who best described Stalin, who he met in Moscow in 1944. In his war memoirs, de Gaulle writes, "Stalin was possessed by the thirst for power, corrupted by a life of plotting, of disguising his features as well as his innermost soul, of ridding himself of illusions, pity, sincerity, seeing in each man an obstacle or a threat. He was all strategy, suspicion, and stubbornness. The revolution, the party, the state, and the war had offered him the occasions and the means of domination."